Hi, good morning. In the last class, we discussed the taxonomic evidences of evidences like morphology, anatomy, and embryology. Now we are going to discuss the remaining part. First one is palynology. You know what is palynology? Palynology is a study of pollen grains. So it plays a very important role in deducing phylogeny and taxonomy. And there is a book written by Erdmann. It is Pollen Morphology and Plant Taxonomy. As this palynology is used in repositioning of taxa, that is disputed taxa. So in order to assign a correct position, we can use palynology. We can check or we can study the structure of pollen grains and thereby we can treat it. And also interpretation of problems relating to origin and also evolution of different groups. And also it is very important in classification of angiosperms. So what are the different characters of pollens we are using? There are pollens vary in shape, size, structure, that is symmetry, and also association of pollen, that is tetrads, or how it is grouped, pollinia, or likewise the nuclear number of pollen grains, and also number and position of furrows. Okay, then you can also check type, number, positions and structure of aperture. You know what is aperture, and the architecture of pollen cell wall, exchange stratification, sculpture, etc. These are the factors or characters of pollen we are usually using to discuss or to study taxonomy. Okay, then first one is a shape, size, symmetry. So what are the characters like the shape? When you look at polar view, circular or triangular, and in the equatorial view, it may be parabolate, it may be spheroidal or perpolate, and size, minute, small, medium, large, very large, etc. Symmetry, radially or bilaterally symmetrical, or if it is asymmetrical, so likewise. And association, that is I already told, in tetrads or in pollinia, you know, two families are the Asclepiadaceae and Orchidaceae. They are characterized by the pollinia. Okay, so pollinia is a special character of these two families. Then monads in single groups, dyads, then tetrads. Monads are characteristic feature of Poaceae. Then aperture, symbol or compound, that are of types like sulcus, ulcus, then colpus, etc. I studied it, monocolpate, tricolpate, likewise. Then extent stratification or ornamentation, that's also very important. Tectate, semi-tectate, intectate like. Okay. Now, exine is an important feature. It's a sculpture or it's a decorations, everything. So, you know, two walls is exine and an exine. And also it contains tectum and vacuoles that you studied already. And if the family or genera, we can identify by looking into these structures. Some examples, Amaryllidaceae, Iridaceae, Cannaceae, etc. are characterized by very smooth exine or very reduced exine and elaborate intine. Okay, and pollen in anemophilus, wind pollinating group, is also special characterized. They are smooth and very thin. Then two groups are there. One is Stenopallinus and another one is Eurypallinus. Stenopallinus means type of pollen is constant and characteristic of the particular group. All the members of that family have same type of pollen grain. That is Stenopallinus. Usually in Asclepiadaceae and Cruciferae. But in the case of Eurypallinus, taxon in which type of pollen may vary. Example, Acanthaceae, Rubiaceae, etc. Wide variation exists in Acanthaceae and Rubiaceae. So usually these Acanthaceae, the pollen grain variation studied, so many papers are available. Then family level one example is Poaceae with a sulcate pollen. Araceae and Lamnaceae also characterized pollen character. Based on that, they put into the same order Arales. It is based on pollen character. Generic level one example is Polygonum. Its seven genera are characterized, differentiated by pollen morphology. And Salix and Populus, another two genera under Salicaceae, is also distinguished on the basis of pollen characters. You have to study examples also. Clear? Okay. Now, species and interspecific level. See, Sharma scientists prepared a key to differentiate 16 Indian species of cypress. Cypress, you know, family Cyperaceae. So this cypress, in order to distinguish so many species are available, he prepared a key. That key is mainly based on what? Mainly based on this pollen characters. And species anemone is distinguished on the basis of germinal aperture of pollen. It is pollen used by germinal aperture of pollen. Okay. Now, the exine pattern is also useful in recognizing different species of Bohinia. Bohinia belongs to Cisalpiniaceae. Okay. And also in Malva, by using pollen size, it is very useful in distinguishing two species of Malva where we are using pollen size. That is the significance of pollen grains. It's a structure. Okay. Now, it is also used to study phylogenetic relationship. And example, some of the palynological data like monocolpate character in Magnoliaceae, and monocolpate is also observed in monocots. So this character help us to study the phylogeny. Clear? Now, so we finished palynology. Now we are move on to chemotaxonomy. So what is chemotaxonomy? The chemical profiling of plants used in taxonomy. Clear? So taxonomical studies, classification based, latest studies are mainly based on this chemotaxonomy. So it helps to improve the system and also have an additional knowledge of phylogeny. Okay. So some of the phytochemical characters, they are the primary constituents like protein, nucleic acid, chlorophyll, etc. They are common in all plants, but some constituents like secondary, like simple phenolic compounds, terpenes, flavonoids, etc. are specific to particular genus or family. Okay. There are two major groups, micromolecules and macromolecules. So there are protein structures like protein banding, amino acid sequence, isoenzyme and alloenzyme analysis, etc. And also recently chloroplast DNA and mitochondrial DNA are used for analysis. And techniques for chemotaxonomy includes gel electrophoresis, PCR, RFLP, RAPD, DNA hybridization, DNA RNA hybridization, etc. Okay. And applications mainly flavonoid systematic. Some examples are the genera, the Peridaridia producing three types of flavonoids. Like in Almaceae also, flavonoids help in describing its affinities. And Fabaceae, the alkaloid distribution is also very significant. Then Asteraceae and Asclepiadaceae have sharing some specific terpenes, etc. Okay. Now, next branch or evidence is cytotaxonomy. Application of cytology in the study of taxonomy. Okay. So, cytology here means chromosomes, its structure, size, shape, behavior, etc. And also, you know, it is helpful in delimiting taxa. When there is a confusion or a disputed taxa arises, you can apply cytotaxonomy. So, karyotyping is very significant, very useful in this taxonomy. Okay. So, there is a work by Raven and Kaihos. They studied, they analyzed karyotype of Magnoliaceae, Hematandraceae and Degeneraceae. You know these three while we are discussing the origin of angiosperms. So, the relationships they studied by using karyotype analysis. Okay. And cytological data are useful in taxonomy of chlorophyte. Then chromosome size and structure. Well, that is also very significant. One example is Yucca and Agave. Yucca having superior ovary, Agave having inferior ovary. Belongs to Yucca in Liliaceae, Agave in Amaryllidaceae. But Hutchinson, by the karyotype analysis, separated them into new family Agaveaceae. Okay. And chromosome behavior and banding pattern also very useful in taxonomic studies. Then, up to this, we finished the some important evidences of taxonomy. Now, we are move on to a brief description of the branch biosystematics. What it includes? The term was introduced by Camp and Gilley. It is actually the relationship to evaluate the phenotypic expression. So, here, the different branches like ecology, genetics, cytology, morphology, everything integrated together. And it includes three steps, its studies. First step is sampling of taxon. This is by സൈറ്റോളജിക്കൽ സ്റ്റഡി ഓഫ് ക്രോമസോംസ് ദാറ്റ് വി സ്റ്റഡിഡ് ഇൻ സൈറ്റോ ടാക്സോണമി. ഓക്കെ, ക്രോമസോംസ് ഓഫ് മെനി പോപ്പുലേഷൻ സ്പീഷീസ് ജനറ എക്സെട്ര, മെനി പോപ്പുലേഷൻ സ്പീഷീസ് ജനറ എക്സെട്ര. ഓക്കെ, ദെൻ ഡിറ്റർമിനേഷൻ ഓഫ് എബിലിറ്റി ഓഫ് ഡിഫറെൻറ്റ് പോപ്പുലേഷൻ ടു ഹൈബ്രഡൈസ്. So the selected population or species, we have to determine whether it is possible to hybridize. Third step is study the homology of chromosome in hybrids. So here we are applying genetics. First part we applied cytology, then the population or species, that is the ecological aspects. So everything combined. Now what is the next step? Information from three steps are compared with the data obtained by morphology and a geographic distribution. Understood? Then these experiments you transplant, breeding behavior, chromosomes and variation plants, everything you consolidate. Okay, now there are four categories described in biosystematics. They are ecotype, a population distinguished by morphological and physiological character. A population that is distinguished how? By morphological and physiological characters, different plants or like that. Then, but it is prevented. What is prevented? The exchange of genes. Different species, etc. In a population, a group, individuals, but they are morphologically and physiologically different. But what is not there? Exchange of genes. That is known as ecotype. Clear? What is ecospecies? It is actually group of plants that contain one or more ecotype. Now you know what is ecotype. Where members, whose members are able to interchange genes. One or more ecotype whose members able to interchange genes. Okay. Now third category, cenospecies. It is actually group representing one or more ecospecies of common evolutionary origin. Okay. Now compendium. It contains actually what? One or more cenospecies that are able to intercross. Clear? So these are the four categories coming under biosystematics. So a brief account is required. Clear? Now, so we finished the taxonomic evidences, morphology, anatomy, palynology, embryology, cytotaxonomy, chemotaxonomy, and also a small description regarding biosystematics. I hope you enjoyed well. Thank you.